Right. So I was here last year with my play Vang, which is a story about immigrant farmers, and it's a what's called a verbatim show. So every single word in the play was taken from an interview, and then I just arranged them and spliced them together. So we had a wonderful day here and did two performances and a workshop and had dinner, and the actors loved it, and we were treated really well. And then this visionary president, Naomi, came up with the idea that we should have a follow-up project. And I said, well, I have this template, storytelling template, where I go into a school or a community center or a conference, and we do storytelling about food and farming, and it can have any kind of slant or focus. And Naomi said, well, we have this population of immigrants in Muscatine, and I said, well, that would really be fun to capture their stories about food and their traditions. And so the next thing I knew, I'm walking into a English as a second language class at the community college, so it's adult learners, and I love the class. The students are from all over the world: China, Mexico, Ecuador, Togo, Congo, Ivory Coast, the Netherlands, Ukraine, Sicily, and many more that I'm not remembering. But I walked into the class and I got them to start telling stories about their food traditions, and we quickly, at first I thought, oh, maybe we're in trouble here, but then I decided to just go with it. We quickly started moving toward weird foods that I have eaten, and they started telling stories about eating rattlesnake and armadillos and earthworms and, you know, different kinds. We got in, one day we got into different kinds of dumplings around the world, and then I realized, no, this is great, and just invite this material into the script. So I recorded it on my phone, and then I'd go home in the afternoon and I would transcribe them. And then you get to the point where you're, there was one day where I thought, oh, I got all these transcriptions, but does this make any sense? I don't know, I ended up coming maybe 5 or 6 times, and it all started to finally started to gel together. And as always happens, there are some really natural storytellers in the group, and then others who work a little harder to tell those stories. But we ended up with not only stories about weird food, but stories that recognized what Native foods are and how they come into our lives, and especially from some of the Americans in the class, realized that their foods were not necessarily their ethnicity, but more the region or the country they lived, their ancestors lived in Europe or Asia or wherever it might be. And so we began to see how food and people travel and intersect, and how food is used to communicate and to bond people together and to celebrate special occasions. And then I basically, it got a lot easier, so I started just arranging the stories so that one would speak to another. And one day somebody, maybe it was the woman from Sicily, was talking about ravioli, or I think something, you know, from her culture. And then we all realized, oh, you know, this culture has their kinds of dumplings, and this culture has theirs, and sometimes they're fried, and sometimes they're in a soup, and sometimes they're steamed. And we realized every culture practically that we could think of, every culture in the room had a dumpling, and every other culture that we could think of had dumplings. And the Africans didn't have dumplings, but they had fufu. And it was just fascinating. And so then one of the teachers in the class pulled up the internet, like dumplings around the world. And we scrolled through and like, oh yeah, I have that, I have that. Oh, that's a pastel, we call it pastel in Brazil or whatever. And so that was a lot of fun. And then the fufu, so about a third of the class was from Africa, and fufu was their main traditional dish. And I hadn't really realized how you made fufu. And so they verbally illustrated how it's from a yam, and you have to take a mortar and pestle and pound it and pound it and pound it, and like big pounding, you know, a lot of energy, a lot of muscle power that goes into fufu, and then it cooks it up and it puffs up like a matzo ball. I guess that's the only thing I could think of that would be comparable. Yeah. So fufu became a dominant theme because they all had their fufu stories. All the African students, and you know, food also elicits stories about one's family, and so there were a lot of mothers in there, like, teaching their kids how to make fufu, or here, now you can make fufu on your own. And same with the Latinx students, you know. There's a story where the mother sends two little boys out into the field to tend to the soybeans and just gives them some tortillas and hot sauce for the whole day, and they end up killing an armadillo and cooking it up, and they come home and the mother said, good, now you know how to fix your own lunch. They're all in that class, they're all at different levels, so they all have different skills, but they were all game. I just got the biggest kick out of them because, you know, there was nobody in there that was like, you know, well, I don't think I want to do this. You know, they were all really engaged and fun. And I just loved when different cultural takes on things would come up. And then sometimes they would interact, like, I think it was one of the women from the Congo said, well, Mary Lisa came in and she brought these black beans. You know, they have these little events where they all bring food. She said, we eat a lot of beans in the Congo, but they're not black. And you know, said, I am sorry, Mary Lisa, I cannot eat black. And so then Mary Lisa from Brazil is like, that is our national dish. How can you turn up your nose at our national dish? And then she explained the history behind it. It connected to slavery in Brazil. And, you know, and I just sat there and I was like, wow, this is world history, you know. And, you know, civil rights and, you know, these different cultures interacting, and it's all has to do with immigration and its different guises. And, you know, everybody eats and everybody has favorite foods, and you know, it's so interesting to frame it culturally. You know, there were days where I just thought, wow, we're like really doing something interesting here. So we hope to bring that interest to the stage too. Yeah, and it's really funny in the show, the man from China, He doesn't want Chinese food. I eat hamburgers. He says, I eat hamburgers. And then the man from Mexico says, you know, I eat all these weird foods in Mexico, but now I like to eat Chinese food. That happened the first day. I'm like, okay, we're using that.
Thank you. welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to this production, this Fork Tales production of Foo Foo and Other International Culinary Delights. All right. I'm happy to be here at the Muscatine Community College. We've been working on this show for over a month, and this represents an English as a Second Language class, and they're members from all over the world. And so they're going to tell you today a little storytelling event about their culinary traditions, foods they like to eat, and weird foods that they have eaten. So, reminder, please kill your cell phones and turn them off, mute them. We don't want the phones going off. Don't be playing with them in here, or I'll come and beat you over the head with my script. That would be great. So relax, enjoy, and listen to these great stories from all over the world. And we're going to start with dumplings. All right. Borscht.
Hello. First of all, I am a Church of God minister. Back in Mexico, we go to a lot of different places. And one place we went to, they invited my wife and I to lunch. And you know how it is, a pastor. You go here, you go here, come here. So I say, fine. So we went there, but they said to me, you cannot ask what you're eating. I said, well, why not? Yeah. I said, okay. So we get there, and the woman, they go to the kitchen, and they come back with a big plate of food, and it's steak and chicken and something else. So I said, excuse me. She said, no. Don't ask. I said, okay. But when I am done eating, I ask. She said, okay. So I ate it. And then I ask, okay, what was it that I was eating? She said, that is the best meat in Oaxaca, Mexico. It is the worm from the cactus. I said, what? That it's about this big and green and slimy. I said, but how? It was so good. She said, it does not matter what it is. What matters is how you prepare it. She never did tell me how to prepare it. But now that I am in the United States, I prefer Chinese food.
Hi, my name is Marilisa Trimboli. I am from Brazil. And what I play was the Chorinho, is Brazilian composer, the Pixinguinha. And here are my story. My family came from Brazil, São Paulo, through Muscatine. So we just arrived. And one day, I think it was in the first month when we came, and my husband come back home, one small packet wrapped up, and he told Marilisa, somebody gave me this to prepare. What is this? Open it. So when I opened, was a meat, one portion meat like this. So I opened, I never saw the meat like this. So I asked him, what kind of the meat is this I never saw in my life? He told me, well, is a deer. Oh my gosh, I don't believe I have a deer in my hands. So I never cook deer. So I don't know what spice I can use. And suddenly came in my mind, do you know the movie, The Bambi? So was in my hands, and I saw the imagine, The Bambi. So, I can't eat this, I can't prepare this. So I told my husband, I can cook it, Atir. I really can cook it because I will not eat. And I, no, but this is only meat. So suddenly I, well, but no vaccination, no control for the issues, no. So my husband, oh, okay, I agree with you, Marilisa. So I not offense. I told my husband, I don't want offense. But we throw away, and we not did not eat a deer. No.
Hi, my name's Carolyn. I'm from Des Moines. I'm a third generation immigrant, so that will come up a bit later. But where I grew up in Des Moines, on our block, there were only two religions represented. We had Jews and we had Catholics. And my theory was always that was because we were, that's how you do it, sorry. We were only a few blocks from two Jewish synagogues and only a few blocks from two Catholic parochial schools. So in those days, all of the kids in the neighborhood hung around together, of course, and would congregate at one home or the other. And if you wanted something to eat, all you did was go to the refrigerator of whatever home you were in, open up the door and take out what you want. So on this occasion, we were at my house, and this young man who maybe was in junior high goes to my parents' refrigerator and opens the door and looks in. And first he turned sort of white, and then he turned sort of green. And then we were sort of worried that he was going to lose it, which thank goodness he did not. But what he found that he was facing was a very large cow's tongue. An entire cow's tongue, with him. And honestly, it did look very much like that. So then I decided to try and figure out why, in fact, there was a cow's tongue in my parents' refrigerator, right, when he was so surprised. And I found that actually cow's tongue, just as you'd expect, you know, is eaten all over the world in lots and lots of countries, in Europe and whatever. But the one country that never came up on that list was Ireland, and I figured this was just too much for my Irish Catholic neighbor.
Hello, everyone. This is Clemente. I'm telling a story of my classmate who's not here. Yes. Thank you. As I was saying, I'm Clementine. I'm telling a story of my classmate who's not here today. He's from Togo. So one day, he came to the United States. The next day, he went to church. And then he don't eat food from America. Then at lunchtime, when they present the food, he said, "What's that?" So they said, "That food." "What food?" "I don't know that food. I can't eat it. Maybe I need to go to my country. I don't know." So he tried, but it was difficult for him. And then maybe he needs to go back to his country. So I said to my friend, "Is it possible to bring food from Africa?" He said, "Yeah, we could shop some food over here." And I said, "Thank God." So the next day, he went there to African market together. And then he saw the food that he liked there and I like in my country. In the African market, you can find rice.
I like rice. I like it.
Okay. So I like goma desi and akume, spinach, maize. You break the core off the cob. Akume, you cook before the maize, flour. You add fish and tomatoes. And it tastes good. Thank you, God. I can buy more food here. After time, I tried to eat the African food, and then I tried to eat food from America. Thank you.
Do you know what? I like rice. If somebody likes rice, put your hand up. Ah, yeah. I clap for you. Me too. Me too, I like rice. My name is Confiance Votio. I am from Cameroon, Cameroon is in Central Africa. In your mind, you see Africa and the Central. Here is Cameroon. In my country, we speak French. Like me, some little people speak again English. But now I would like to speak about one traditional food in my country. But I like rice. Yes. The name of that food is taro. T-A like apple, R-O, taro. How can I cook it? You go to the market, you find something. The name in my country is makumba. Makumba. That's the name in my country, the makumba. You buy it, you bring it at home, you cook. It's not too hard to cook. It's very, very easy to do that. You cook it. After that, you have to make a sauce. The yellow sauce is the name, yellow sauce, like a color, yellow. You find the first time the palm oil. You bring in the water, you mix together, you mix it. You use your hand, you mix a lot. Don't worry, you wash your hand first. Nope. You mix, yes, you mix, you mix. You put the salt, you taste it, you put again, you put the pepper, if you like a pepper, you mix again. You mix. Do like me, mix. Try to mix it. Yes, try. Yes, like that. Yes. You mix a lot. Mix a lot. After that, if you are vegetarian, you put the fish. If you are not vegetarian like me, you put the milk, a chicken, a lot of things if you want. After that, you eat it. It's very, very good. Very good. But I like rice. Yes. Thank you so much.
In China, we cook rice. Rice for lunch, rice for dinner. In the United States, I just eat a hamburger. I like hamburger. I go out and buy some hamburger in Walmart and the bigger store. Chinese food is not my favorite. Hamburger are easy, save time. My wife still cook Chinese at home. It's just like going back to China. I think my wife looks a hamburger, knows hamburger too. He likes hamburger too. Sometime we go to Walmart together. I had an American Thanksgiving here, but not. I don't like turkey. Turkey is too much turkey. Mashed potato, I think is okay. Mashed potato and gravy. Mashed potato, much better. French fries, we never eat at home, just in Walmart.
So, this is me again. I have another story of my classmate. So, for fufu, it is kind of, you can make fufu with plantain or whatever. Instead of bread, we cook yams. For fufu, you cook yam, you mash the yam. After that, you put that on the plate, and then after that, you prepare the sauce. Believe me, it tastes good. And a good sauce, you put in the good meat, a little of water, you add in onions, the pepper, you add the salt, prepare to cook the good sauce. After that, you eat the food, the fufu, so it's very, very good. He's from Togo and I'm from Congo, and believe me, it is good. Thank you.
Hello, my name's Rachel, and I'm actually one of the teachers here with my wonderful students here. And I'm actually going to tell you my own story a little bit later. Now I'm going to tell a story of Iris, who is from Holland, from the Netherlands, and she comes and helps us on Mondays. And I thought it would be good for me to tell the story because actually I was educated for the most part in Holland, in Dutch and in Belgium. And so when she told the story, it very much related to my memories as a child and eating as well. So first of all, pancakes, right? You know what pancakes are like, and most people like pancakes. Well, in Holland, they have what's called pannenkoeken. And pannenkoeken is a little bit different than pancakes. They're more like crepes, so they're thinner and they're delightful. And people don't eat them just for breakfast. They also have them for lunch and for dinner as well. And people put sugar, lemons, and obviously fruits and all sorts. And they're just absolutely wonderful. And Iris said she very much missed her pannenkoeken from being here in America. And she loved to get stroop, which is syrup, but we call it stroop, obviously, in the Netherlands, and put that all over her pannenkoeken. And then she spoke, too, about bread and how bread back home in Holland was a bit different than it is here in America. It's much thicker, and she will go to the bakery every day and get it directly. And then she told a story about hagelslag, which evoked memories for me too. I remember being in Holland and going to a friend's house for lunch, and they had what this thing called hagelslag, and I said, well, what's that? Well, it's hagelslag in Dutch, translated means hailstorm. And what they are little pieces of chocolate that look like chocolate icicles that you spread on your bread. And Iris said that is probably the thing that she absolutely misses the most about being here in America, away from the Netherlands, her hagelslag.
Hello, my name is Angela. I want to tell you the story about food, about my mom and my husband. My husband went to a Chinese restaurant. He ate a piece of, it looked like chicken. He didn't know, he thought it was chicken, so he got some and he ate it. I mean, it was good. So after he ate it, he went back to take more pieces. That's where he saw the sign that says frog legs. He didn't like it. He didn't mean to eat a froglet. It was good though. It was good. But after that, whenever he goes to a Chinese restaurant, he always check and double check the tag to make sure that he doesn't eat frog leg anymore. Yeah, this is my mother's story. My mother's name is Magdalene. She usually went to the market in Togo and bought meat that she liked too much. One day she went to the market and she didn't see her favorite meat seller. Then she asked about her to her neighbor. She answered her that it didn't rain, so there is any earthworm in the farm. She was terrified of knowing that she was eating giant earthworm all this time.
Hi everyone, my name is Domenica Vitali, I'm Italian. My town I'm from is Palermo in Sicily. And I live here in Muscatine for 15 years with my husband, kids, and my father-in-law, Paparino. My father-in-law is very cooking very good. And when I got married, I didn't know to cook. I'm not ashamed. And he teaches me a lot. He's cooking much better than me. And my mom is 89 years old. And I'm the whole of my family live here in the States. All my family lives in Sicily. And usually she live alone, but my family is around here. But she miss a lot my father because she's a widow. And I usually call her 2 times a week. And every time when I call her, she complains. She has a pain. She has a headache. She's always complaining, maybe because she misses my father, of course. And usually I go every year for 3-4 weeks. And I live in my mom's house. I stay in my mom's house. She's changed a lot. She got a lot of energy. She very activity. She cook every day for me, especially she cook whatever I like it. And she spoke to me a lot. And Sunday she wake up and she start to cook at 9 o'clock in the morning, because the food for us, especially in South Italy, is very important. With the food, we make a lot of relation with the family and with the neighborhood. And the tradition of Sunday meal for my mom, she is spaghetti with the meatball. And she make a Milanese. Milanese is a kind of very tiny meat. And she put in the mixed eggs, and then she season the breadcrumb. And then she fry. And she put it with the salad. And then, of course, for us, it's very important after dinner, drink espresso coffee. We are very espresso coffee. And every morning, we usually make espresso coffee. And all my family come in my house when I'm going to Italy. And every morning we make espresso and we call all the neighbors. And we have a talk together for about, that's excuses for talk around about an hour. And my mom, she doesn't even not complain, not pain, and not headache. She's very happy because her house is full with the company and with the family. That's very important for me. That's it. Thank you.
Hi, Carolyn again, back in Des Moines, Iowa again. Also on this block where we lived, and this was back in the 50s, there was a grandmother who lived in almost every home in that block. That was very much what was happening right back then, if there was one aged grandparent. And my grandmother lived with my family from before I was born until long after I'd left home. She was the immigrant. She was from Poland. She had come over when she was maybe about 18. And she, when she was there, she came from a very small town called a shtetl. And the way that the family functioned, actually, was that her father would have been in the synagogue during the day studying the Jewish holy books, and she would be not, you know, her mother would be taking care of the children, the house, and, in fact, taking care of everything financially, which meant that she was raising the poultry and the food and whatever. So needless to say, she was the main cook in our home, right, as well. And I assumed that all the special dishes that she made were Jewish, you know, that I was eating Jewish food. And this made sense because of all of my friends who were Jewish, they were all eating the same sort of food. It was like we all had the same recipes, in fact. So I have two little stories, however, that taught me that was not the case. The first was that I met an artist couple, and they were from Poland, and we became friends, and they asked us to dinner, and I said that'd be fine, and they said, did we like soup? I said, of course we loved soup. Well, they actually were serving cold soup. I said, oh, well, the only cold soup that I know is borscht, and then they looked at me, because in fact, that's what they were serving. Now, somehow we had failed to connect the fact that they were Polish now, and that I was a Jewish American with a grandmother from Poland, and of course we were all eating the same food, obviously. So that was my first lesson. Now, you'd think I would have figured it out, but I did not. The next thing that happened was I went to Madison, Wisconsin, and I was going to eat at a Russian restaurant for the first time. And I was all excited because I'd never had Russian food. Or so I thought. Once again, I sit down, I open the menu, the very nice waitress walks up to me and says, "Can I help you understand anything?" And I sort of looked shocked and mumbled and said, "No, gee, actually, this is all my comfort food." And in fact, I apparently forgot, you know, the proximity of all of Eastern Europe, and that my grandmother, in fact, was also cooking Russian food as well as Polish food. So somewhere between those two lessons, it dawned upon me that most of our ancestors, I'm sure, moved around. They moved and other people moved into the areas where they were. And what we all did was adapt and adopt the foods from the cultures that we all knew and from the cultures, right, that we interacted with. So somewhere in there, I finally learned that food really has much more to do with culture and geography than it does with religion.
I want to introduce Irina. Irina is from Ukraine. And she worked for me in my restaurant for about 2 months, And she doesn't speak English, and my husband doesn't speak Ukraine. And they communicate with the translate phone. And one day she brought Ukraine food, and I never tried in my life, but she brought the I tried my first time and it was very, very, very good. And for sure she cooked very well.
Thank you. I am Irina. I'm from Ukraine. Tradition food Ukraine, this borscht. Eat meat with vegetable. Meat, more meat. Cook cabbage, potatoes, tomatoes, onion, garlic, Ukraine beef borscht. Sorry, thank you.
Hello. Now, this story takes place in New Mexico. Now, in New Mexico, the nights are very cold, but the day is very hot. So one day I was there with the church and they decided to go out to have a picnic. And at this picnic they had all kinds of different foods, but for them there was something missing. So what they did is they go down into the rocks, into the ground, and they find two rattlesnakes. And they go pop, pop, and they shoot up in the head. Then they get the knife and they cut off their head and they skin them. So then they get them and we come back and they cook them like how you cook deer, rotisserie. Mm-hmm. So they cook it for a little bit and they said, "Do you want some?" I said, "What? No, not like that." They said, "Oh, come on." I said, "Okay, fine. But I put hot sauce on it." So I try this rattlesnake, and it's pretty good. It's chewy, kind of. And they say that sometimes they let it dry out to like a powder. And the powder, they can put on a lot of different things. And it can help with things like anemia, acne, and diabetes. So if the snake bites you, you die. But if you eat the snake, then you live.
Chinese people eat hot and spicy, but I don't like hot. I like light. I like vegetables. And yesterday, I and my wife went to Walmart and buy some these vegetables. This is green, this is white dal here, baicai. I like baicai, very nice. I can buy just a few of vegetables here that we have in China. Walmart have a few, and Aldi, and we go to the Asia market in Davenport, in Iowa City. Every family cooks in the dishes at home. We buy at Walmart, then cook it at home. I am not very familiar with cooking. I just eat the rice, vegetable. My wife is a very good cook.
Hi. Brazil again. This is the story of my daughter, Leticia. So we have a friend, they are family, and they became a grandparents. Is the first child born in his family. So the baby turned the first birthday, the 1 year. So a whole family was preparing a big birthday party for the child, the first year. So they invite a lot of people because they are on the Mexican restaurant. So the food, the kind of all style Mexican food in this party. So they invite a lot of people. It was a huge party. And have a lot of dishes, many, many dishes, beef, chicken, and the lamb, and the outside dish. So we went to serve, and oh, was Mexican food, was delicious. And my daughter, her husband asked, Leticia, what do you like it? What do you, for your favorite dish? Oh, everything is good, but the lamb, oh my, is really good. I will take the second plate, the lamb. So she went and she got the second place, the lamb. Well, almost finished the party, she went to the parents, the baby's parents, and the grandpa, grandma say, oh, thank you for invite us. Thank you for so beautiful party. The food was delicious, but the lamb, oh my gosh, the lamb was the best. So the grandma told, oh, did you like it? Was linda. So my daughter froze. So we come back. So my the mom's baby sent in Facebook a picture. Oh, look what the grandpa gave to my child, one lamb. So mom, she sent it to me. Did you see, mom, in your backyard, my backyard with my neighbor, yeah, backyard is a huge, and they, oh, have a lamb. I look in my kitchen window. Oh my gosh, has a lamb. So it's not baby. She's adult. She's a big one, fat one. And oh my gosh, we have a lamb in, I can't see in backyard, no, only squirrel.
Squirrel?
So, okay. So my daughter asked me, okay, mom, when you become now, what you will buy to pet. Eu, oh, okay, I will buy a pony. So the competition, no? Oh, I will buy a pony. So the thing is this, the lamb wasn't a pet for the child. It was for the dish. So it's a Linda. She, oh my gosh, so my daughter told mom, I ate Linda. I can't believe it. I ate Linda, but it was delicious.
Well, hello again. As I said before, my name's Rachel Riley Smock, and I am one of the ESL instructors here at the college. And going on my fourth year here, and for almost 20 years, I was actually a social worker here in town. And I've come back to my roots, really, because I was born in Sweden in the Arctic Circle of British parents, of Irish grandparents, and my whole, up till I was a teenager, we moved from country to country, and my beloved parents didn't think I should go to the British schools or to the American schools, the international schools. No, indeed, they sent me to the local schools. So I went and we lived in Holland, Belgium, Sweden, Switzerland, England, and Ireland, but every time we moved, I would have to learn a new language. So by the time I was 12, I spoke 6 languages. If I wanted to play with the other children in the neighborhood, I needed to learn the language, obviously. So I tell my students that story every time when a class first starts in the beginning of the semester, because I tell them I know what it's like to sit in a classroom and not understand a single word. And I just want to take a moment and have you really understand how brave they are. Not only are they up here acting and telling their stories, they're telling the story in their non-native language. Are they not doing a fantastic job? In our class, we have, through the years, had probably about 25 to 30 different countries represented. And at any given time, we sit down and we talk about the countries that people come from and all the different languages that are spoken. And we have had, at one time, 25 to 30 different languages spoken by all the students in the class. So for little Muscatine, Iowa, which I always laugh because here we are from all over the world ending up in Muscatine, Iowa. And we really have grown incredibly internationally, Muscatine. Anyway, enough of that, but I just did want to say that because I thought it was very important because the English language acquisitions class here at the college, we have incredible staff, and obviously the college is very supportive of us, and this project with Mary Swander has been tremendous, and we're so happy to have been a part of it. Anyway, on to my story. So as I said, we first moved to the United States as a teenager, I did. And I have 4 brothers. And one of my older brothers, Mark, came over to visit us for the summer holidays. He was coming over from, was at the University of Liverpool at the time. And we decided that we wanted to go to McDonald's because we had never been to McDonald's before. We'd been to Wimpy's and other hamburger places in Europe, but we'd never been to McDonald's before. So, of course, we were so excited. It was going to be tremendous. So we head off to McDonald's, and we walk in, and, of course, we're overwhelmed by the incredible smells of the hamburgers and the French fries, or chips, as we call them back home. And we get up to the counter, and we're looking at the menu, and it's just so many choices, and we're overwhelmed, but we're so excited. So the lady says, "What would you like?" And I said, "Well, I'd like a hamburger." "You'd like a hamburger? Would you like a regular hamburger?" Yeah. Well, what do you mean? What's a regular hamburger? Is there such a thing as an irregular hamburger?" And my brother and I, you must know this. Now, what's so funny now is that he's has a silly humor like I do, very Monty Python sort of silly humor. And the rest of our family does actually not like to be around us when we're together because we act really daft, right? But anyway, so we, of course, well, we were just howling with laughter with this regular business. And of course, then it was, "Would you like fries?" "Well, would you like regular fries?" "Well, what again? What are regular versus irregular? Would you like a regular Coke?" oh, okay, all right. So we were laughing and obviously having a big laugh with that. And then we said, well, actually, we want our food to go, and we would like it, you know, regular to go. We're not sure if there's an irregular to go. But anyway, we'd like it to go, and we'd like a regular to go bag, because we want this regular to go hat to put on our heads. Just why? Well, just to be silly. And we put them on our heads, and we were still speaking to the lady at the counter who thought we'd grown horns because we were so incredibly crazy. And my brother and I just were laughing and giggling and having a laugh. And of course, my mother walked out because she was mortified by us acting so silly. But it was so amazingly, and still to this day, whenever I go out for dinner or whatever, and they say, would you like a regular Coke or a regular something, I always laugh because it just reminds me of that. And we have all these choices, and that was just something that I'd never experienced before. And it just was fantastic and just a funny little story. So again, thank you for joining us all today, too. It was fantastic.
I'm also a teacher here with the ELA program. I'm not used to having something being brought up to me. I'm not tall at all. But I'm also a teacher here at MCCD. I get to teach with Rachel. It's a lot of fun. And just to let you know, we all, some of us, try to wear things that came from where we are from, like with Ireland, and so, well, they know that I'm from Brazil. Yes, they've got the Brazil, you've got the five, you know, the soccer things. I am not from Muscatine, so the closest I came to was wearing, I'm close to San Francisco is where I grew up, so 49ers, go for it. That's all I could come up with at the last minute because I didn't have something from my country there. But everyone did try and bring something from their country, and I love teaching. I think I started gaining a love of languages when it was my first language learning Spanish. And I got to go to Ecuador and just get engulfed in Spanish and the language and the culture. And when I went to live there, that I was just one of the things. That this is my food story now. I just love languages, and I love, and that's when I, getting to live in another country, nobody in Ecuador looks like me. So I was looking forward, though. People told me that I might get to try one of the local dishes called cuy. And so I said, okay, well, that sounds fun. I'm up for anything. I lived there for about a year and a half. They told me what cuy was going to be like. They told me cuy was guinea pig. I said, well, that's okay. I'll try that. I've never tried rabbit. I've never tried anything quite like that before. But if somebody gave it to me, of course I would try that. I don't have anything against that personally. I never had a guinea pig for a pet, so I don't have any bad feelings about that personally necessarily. And I wouldn't want to offend anybody. They didn't have it anywhere on the menus or anywhere in the cities that I was in. So they said, well, maybe out on the ranches or up in the mountains where maybe they grow it, where they have it on the farm, like they have rabbits, where they raise rabbits, raise chickens, raise guinea pig to eat guinea pig. And I thought I finally had my chance because I did. I did visit a lot of people who were in those rural areas, never got a chance. Maybe it was because I looked like this that they didn't give it to me. I was a little disappointed that I didn't even get the chance to see what it was like. Came back to the States, came back home, and I saw this documentary on this beautiful hotel that was built basically to save some of the rainforest there. And it was, a lot of people came, and the reason they came was to give money to also help support some of the land there. It was a very nice, beautiful, beautiful hotel. And the restaurant they had there, I don't know if they'd call it a delicacy, but it was definitely a local thing that was in Ecuador. They served cuy, and I finally got to see what a picture of it looked like, and it did look like just a rat without hair on it. Served whole, still never got to eat it, but it was there in the documentary, so it was there.
Now, this is a story of when I was younger, and it was me and my little brother, well, my older brother. I was little, I was 7 to 10 years old, and we had this farm. And one day, it rained a lot. So we had to go out and make sure the beans were okay. So we went out, but my mother was too busy, she could not make us lunch. So before I left, I grabbed some tortillas and some hot sauce. And we left. We brought shovels to, you know, dig the water out if we needed to, and a machete to cut things. So we go out and we are working, and eventually my brother says, I am hungry, what are we going to eat? I said, I don't know. And eventually we look down and we find an armadillo. And I look at him, I say, well, what do you think? He said, well, I'm hungry. I said, okay. So we take the machete and kah, we kill the armadillo. But then we have a problem. We don't have any pots, any pans, or anything to cook this armadillo with. So we decided to make a bonfire, and we have a lot of wood and fire, and we cook it for about 15 to 20 minutes. And eventually we say, well, how are we going to eat this armadillo? You know, the top is hard, we cannot go that way. And we say, okay, and we turn it around. And the bottom was soft. And I look at him again, I said, are we going to eat this armadillo? He says, yeah. So I grab the hot sauce and I put hot sauce in the armadillo. And I grab a stick I find on the ground and I mix it up. And then I get the meat from the armadillo and put it in my tortillas. And then for the first time in my life, I had armadillo tacos. So then we go back to the house, and I tell my mother about what we did and what we ate and about the tacos. And she says, well, yes, you can find anything out there to eat. And she says, see, now next time, I don't have to cook lunch for you.
Hello, my name is Elizabeth. I was actually born in Chicago, but I was raised in Mexico. So, for the armadillo, I'll clean it inside, but my mom will clean it outside. So my mom will take the head off and take the tail off. So after that, she will clean it and she will cook it in a rotisserie. It's actually, like, it's good, but it was my first time, so it was kind of like chewy. My grandma, like, she lives, her house is, like, it's big, so she has, like, all the way in the back is, like, trees and grass and other stuff. And she will go and look for them. She will look, and we will take the dogs out so they can go and hunt them and look for the armadillo. Once she will, the dogs will grab it, they will start barking and barking. That's when we knew, okay, we have to go, like, the dogs already got something. So we will go all the way down. And the first thing that my dog had one, so he couldn't like let it go, because if he let it go, the armadillo would go. So I was running down and I saw this. It was like, it's like a hammer, but I don't know if you guys see like those big ones, those heavy ones. So I just went down and running. I don't know how I picked it up, but I picked that thing up and I just smashed it on his head. And I was like scared, because I was like, I'm gonna hit my dog, or if I hit the armadillo, whatever, if I hit my dog. So it was like, okay, you have to hit the armadillo. So I was like, just hit it. So I just went once. It was like, so I was like, okay, that's it. So my dog let it go. My grandma grabbed it. She started taking it off. And honestly, it was good. I'm not gonna lie. It was good.
Okay, hello. My name is Alexander. I am from Togo, West Africa. One day, my wife and I and two of friends went to Davenport to have fun. We got it hungry, but when we are just newcomer and we don't know our location here, it has been something hard for us. And so we were continue working and thinking sincerely, where can we find a restaurant? There isn't any Togolese food. It had for us, and it was raining. Then we saw a Japanese restaurant closed by. And I said, okay, let's go try it. Maybe we will like it. It's good to try. If we try, we may like something. Letting my friend and my wife to know that by continuing to ask and looking and thinking sincerely about hungry as we are, we don't have to be angry with people. So we have to go slow. So we go there and they give us the menu list. And it was hard to find what to eat. It was very hard. So, okay, we had to pick something to eat. So I said, let's pick one. And everybody picked the one he liked to eat. So when they brought the food, they brought a big bowl of rice. Rice also, as we are eating it at all the time, oh, we were very happy. And we say, rice, welcome, welcome, welcome. It was like a bone soup. And I don't know what they used to cook it. So as I don't know how and what do they use to cook it now, we just took 2 spoonfuls. And we didn't finish because we didn't like it. Miso soup, we didn't like it. So we really were hungry. And I said, let's find something to eat. We made a wrong choice. After that, I said, let's go home. So we came back home, and I cook African food. And we eat it together. And people, when we was eating that, when we were eating that, they are saying that, oh, just now are we in Africa or we are here in America again? And I just tell them, please continue. When you will finish eating, I will let you know. And people, and so my wife is telling also other friend that, yes, being newcomers here. And going, continuing to just know location and areas and wherever we gotta be now, so we will know more about America. Very nice.
So this is me again. This is a story about me, about black beans. So I learned English in Muscatine Community College. So English here is second language. And at the end of each semester, we have a party. So one day we have a party, and then Marisa over here, she brought black beans. And we have beans in my country, but we don't have black beans. So I was surprised, my first time to see black beans. So do you know black beans? I don't know if you know black beans. I was like, what's this? I didn't want to eat it because it was my first time. I don't know what it tastes. I don't know how. I'm sorry, Marisa, I didn't like it. But so.
She was afraid.
Yes, exactly. I was afraid. It was very different, but I didn't like it. I didn't like it. But after that, another day, she brought black beans. It was good, it was not bad. So I just want to say thank you because you pushed me to eat your black beans. Thank you.
You see, the second time, not so bad.
Thank you very much.
Well, black beans in my country became the national dish. So if you ask for Brazilian people what you want to eat, they will say black beans. We call feijoada because in Portuguese, beans is feijão, so came the root. Feijoada. So we use cook
with bacon, smoked sausage, and dry meat. But this dry meat, a specific dry meat, I can't find here in US. It's very different because they get the fresh meat, but a lot salt and dry in the sun in hot days. So this meat come very dry. So when you go to supermarket, you buy this meat and put in water for take out all salt and use in the feijoada. But here in US, I have bacon, I have smoked sausage and the black beans and the all garlic, onion, so it's very good. And in winter time, is very, very good food because make you warm and strong. It's a strong food. So in my country, when we met the whole family, my grandma, mom, my sisters, my sister-in-law, we met for cook feijoada because it's good for a lot of people. So we can invite you for try the feijoada like Clementine. So this have one story about my country, this food, because many years ago, this food became the national dish in my country, but came from slaves, because slaves work in the farms and the rich people in the rich house. So they cook the good part, the best part, the pork for the rich people. So what they don't use, so they take it and they mix it with the black beans. So they became the national dish, but came from slaves. So this is a little history of our food in our country. Thank you.
Okay, Alexander, yes, it is. Presenter, I am. It is having African food from Togo and eating it together. So having that food here now, I'm remembering eating that food in my country. That food is better than American food. It makes me happy. And it makes me look at myself like I am in West Africa, in my country, Togo. In my country, we have yams. Fufu, yes. We have peanut butter. You put the peanut butter in the sauce and voila. We have the peanut butter here and tomatoes. I put it together. And if I have a chicken or I have a fish, yes. If my phone is ringing, I can't know because I am eating fufu. Mashing up the yams takes a long time, but having fufu, it's worth it. Here we have the powdered yams. We just buy the powder. We prepare it faster. One day, my mother was in the kitchen and she was doing something. She called us to be there and to look at her, and she's cooking things for us to know when we got to be to somewhere and we don't have someone to help us. For us, as she let us know more about how to cook it now, it gotta be easy for us. So being hungry, we will not thinking about her, but having the knowledge how to cook it now, we gotta just think about the kitchen to to be there and cook. She wanted it to be easy for us. So my family is not here, my mother and my father. So who is going to cook for me? I'm cooking for myself. Yes. Tired, if I'm cooking and I'm tired, I can just go sit down. My wife also asks, you know, how to cook it. So she will just come and do the rest and she will call me. And when we gotta go on eating, maybe someone can be present and he will just beating the door. As we are eating, if someone don't come and beat me, I can know that someone is touching the door because I'm eating fufu. So fufu, yes, I'm very happy for that. Being here in America also, yams, every day I'm thinking sincerely. If it was like I can have yams number, phone number to call to say yams, come. Oh, so very nice.
Obviously, we've been hearing how important food is to all of us and food from all of our cultures. My last little story has to do with, yes, a particular time and how important food was to this and to the whole occasion and how it interacted with it. And this is when my spouse-to-be and I were planning our wedding. This was years and years ago, and trust me, there were not destination weddings, right? You got married wherever you were going to get married, and if you had any friends there, fine, and if not, if anybody could afford it, they might come or they might not. Now, at this point, we had both been away from our families for years and years, so our friends were all over the country. My parents were still in Iowa, and my husbands-to-be were in Illinois. So we decided we would have a very small wedding. We'd all meet in Chicago, just with the parents and the siblings and our grandparents. So we did that. And the night before, you know, actually we went there and we all had a few days to spend, which was really fun. And then at the end of that period, we were going to have our wedding. So the night before we were going to get married, my future father-in-law took us to dinner. His immigrant story was that his parents had arrived from Finland. And they had gone to the upper in Minnesota, and his father had worked in the coal mines. The unfortunate story there, if we know our history, is that his father had died in his early 20s from black lung disease, from working in those coal mines. His mother then remarried, and my husband-to-be father was raised in Massachusetts in another Finnish community. So it was his culture was very critical to him. So it wasn't a surprise. He took us to a Scandinavian restaurant. And I was finally right. I didn't know Scandinavian food. I really, really didn't. And it was wonderful. It was all this fresh fish, you know, and gorgeous, wonderful dishes. And then, as good as the food was, this was a dinner theater. And it was a dinner theater with little puppets. So there we were, and the puppets started the play My Fair Lady, which we knew some of, you know. Well, a lot of people know pieces and parts of it, and we knew some of the songs, but not all of them. And all of a sudden, they broke into song with, I'm getting married in the morning. And my spouse-to-be and I looked at each other and grinned and giggled, because in fact, we were going to be married in the morning, and we were, and we did. So.